everybody. How are y'all tonight? Amen. Hallelujah. I have a couple of quick announcements. I feel awkward when I do the announcements because I really don't like to talk on the microphone. I know it's weird. But on Sunday night, there was a sweet little girl that may have left her size 10 britches. So nobody in the youth is claiming these, and I'm pretty sure most of us adults can't claim them either. But if you have a size 10 girl and you know you left some britches, we're going to have them on the front row for you to pick up. We need to pray for Brother Alton Davison. He is currently being treated for pneumonia. He's got Alzheimer's, and his wife has just asked us to just pray over him. Next Sunday is graduation. It's such an important Sunday, and we're having a potluck after morning service, so please bring something to eat. That Sunday, June 6th, sign up for VBS. Who's excited? Oh, nobody's excited for VBS? Okay, so we have VBS. We need kids to get registered. We'll have forms on Sunday, and then we also need lots of volunteers. So a lot of people might say, well, it's during the day, I can't volunteer. Well, guess what? It's in the evening. So most of us can volunteer. There's no excuses. So just be prepared. That's going to be June 14th through the 17th, and then we have the missions banquet June 12th, and that is being hosted by Pastor Guillermo. So the missions banquet. Amen. So we're going to pray, and we're going to go into worship. So if you guys will just stand in this place. Hallelujah. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father. Brother Anthony's going to pray tonight.
Lord, I thank you for us being here tonight. I thank you for letting everyone make it here safe, Lord. I ask tonight that you would let your Holy Spirit fall, that we would find you in a new reality tonight, Lord, that you would just, Lord, let our hearts and our minds and our ears be open to you, Lord God. To, Lord, as we worship you, that we just let ourselves go and worship, Lord, that we don't care who's around, that we don't care who's on the left or the right, Lord, but we are in it for you, Lord. God, this is a corporate race to a certain extent, but it's also an individual race, Lord. Lord, help us, Lord, to dive in, Lord, and stay on that straight and narrow path tonight as we enter into worship tonight. Lord, I thank you for just shielding Pastor while he's out of town. I thank you for keeping him safe and bringing home safe to us this weekend. Lord, I thank you for the ones who aren't even able to be here, Lord, but able to be here online. Lord, thank you for touching them where they are, Lord, because we don't know who they are or where they're at. But you know, Lord, you can reach out across the oceans and the miles, Lord, and touch them where they are. Lord, I thank you for this day. In Jesus' name, Lord, I ask you to bless this service. Amen.
Pray for Brother Davison. No. Father God, we just lift Brother Davison up. Father God, Lord, I pray that you put your Holy Ghost angels around him in that room. Father, I pray for peace upon his wife, his family. Jesus, God, let them know that you have him in your hands and that you are perfectly crafting his care. Father God, I pray for a miraculous healing, Father God, of this pneumonia. Father God, every other ailment that has infected that body, Father God, Lord, I pray that you just touch him, Father, from the top of his head to the soles of his feet, Father God, for a miraculous healing, Father. We're living in a time where we are seeing your miracles more often, God, and I want to hear about this praise report, Father God. Lord, I thank you for the healing. God, I pray for Sister Gloria, Father God, Brother Renee's wife. Father, I pray that you just touch her body right now. Lord God, I pray that you move from the inside out, Father God, that she would be completely healed, her mind would be changed, all these things would happen to her body, Father God, that a wheelchair is not her portion, Father God, that she will rise, she will walk, she will be healthy, and she will be whole. Father God, we thank you for your blessings. We thank you, Father, that you have opened the window of heaven upon this place, Father. Lord, that we are seeing who you are. We are seeing your love. We are seeing your miracles, your signs, your wondrous, Father God. Lord, we thank you that you have planted the harvest here, Father God. Lord, we thank you that we are going to see that harvest come to pass, God. Lord, I thank you for the times of revival, Father God. They're so close, Father God. The fire is building, Father. Lord, I pray that we don't become idle and we don't allow the fire to go out, Father God. Lord, I pray that you create a hunger and a desire within each of us, Father God. Lord, that we can come to you and we worship you, Father. Lord, not for the works that you do, but for who you are. God, that you gave us a second chance. You gave us the breath in our lungs. Lord, that you gave us our salvation. Come on, people. This is time to press in. Father God, we just thank you, Father, for your mighty wonders. Lord, we thank you, Father, for everything that you are, everything that you're doing. Father God, we thank you. We thank you. We thank you. Lord, we thank you. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Jesus. We praise your name. We praise your name, Jesus. Hallelujah.
And here I am to worship. Here I am to bow down. Here I am to say that you're
yourself a reality to us tonight, God.
The more I find you, the more I love you.
Sing that again.
The more I seek you, the more I find you, the more I find you, the more I love you. I want to sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe, and feel your heart beating. This love is so deep, it's more than I can stand. I'm melting in peace, it's overwhelming. I want to sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe, and feel your heart beating. This love is so deep, it's more than I can say. The more I find you, the more I find you, oh, the more I love you. I want to sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe. Drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe, and feel your heart beating. This love is so deep, it's more than I can stand. I'm melting in peace, it's overwhelming. Majesty. Singing majesty, majesty, singing majesty, majesty. Come on and worship the King of Kings. Your grace has found me just as I am.
given us an opportunity to be changed forever.
You're all together. altogether wonderful. You're wonderful. You're wonderful to me. Here I am, Lord. Here I am. I'm here to worship you in all I do. Here I am. Can you tell him that tonight? Here I am, Lord. I'm here to worship you with every breath I take. Every movement I make, God, I want to worship you in everything I do, Father. Can you tell him that tonight? Can you tell him that tonight? Here I am. Here I am to worship you, Lord, Majesty. You're all too good. Together, wonderful, you're wonderful to me. I want to sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hand, lay back against you and breathe, and feel your heart beating. This love is so deep. It's more than I can stand. I melt in your peace. It's overwhelming. I want to sit at your feet, drink from the cup in your hands, lay back against you and breathe, and feel your heart beating. This love is so deep. It's more than I can stand. I melt in your peace. It's overwhelming, Majesty. Come on and sing Majesty. Majesty. Sing Majesty. Majesty. Majesty, come on and worship him, Majesty. Majesty, have your way, Lord. Majesty, forever I am changed by love in the beauty of your Majesty. Thank you, Jesus. Father, we praise you. We thank you, Father. We thank you, Father, that you have set this atmosphere, Father God, that we can receive every word that you have to say, God, that we can feel your touch, God. We can see you. We can hear you, Father God. And we can feel your breath in our lungs. God, we thank you that you have rested your presence upon this place tonight, God. Father, I pray that we don't get the confusion and the things that may try to interfere as a word is being spoken tonight, God, that we're not concerned with the left or the right. We're not concerned about yesterday. We're not concerned about tomorrow, God, but we're going to live in the moment knowing that you are the King. You are the King. You are the Lord. You are the breath that we breathe, Father, that everything that we're going through, you've already taken care of it. God, we're going to rest in knowing that your presence has surrounded us tonight, Father. That we could sit at your feet. That we could drink from the cup in your hand, God. We know that your presence is here tonight, Father. And we worship you. We worship you. We worship you. You are the King of Kings. You are the Lord of Lords. God, I thank you for stirring up a hunger and a desire within us tonight, Father God, that we can rest in your presence, Father, knowing that it is all taken care of. You have already done it for us, God. We can praise you. We can rest in knowing. We can be satisfied. You will fill our hunger. You will fill the desires of our heart, Father God. The more we seek you, God, we are going to find you. God, your word will become alive to us. It will become a lamp, an
into our feet, and it will shine a bright light for our path, Father, that we could keep the straight road and follow you, Father, that narrow road, God, that your light will shine and it will draw us near to you, Father God. We are going to rest in your presence tonight, Father. We thank you, Jesus. We praise your holy name, Father. We thank you. Father God, as Brother Anthony comes, Lord, I pray that you just wash over him tonight, God. Lord, that his words come straight from your throne room, Jesus. God, that your blood will wash over him tonight, Father God. That your peace will wash over him. God, every word he says, every step that he takes, Father, everything that comes out of his mouth will be directly from you tonight. Father, Lord, we thank you for the man of God that he is, Father God. I thank you, Father, for blessing me with him. God, I thank you, Father, that you have put him before us tonight, Father, so we can glean off of the words that he has to say, God. Help our hearts to be ready. Help our ears to be ready, Father God. Help our minds to be clear and to rest in knowing that you are King. God, we thank you. We praise you, Father. We thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah.
Lord, thank you tonight. Thank you tonight. Lord, I ask that you would just, oh, Lord, fall on this place even heavier than you are now. Oh, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Lift your hands one more time. The presence of God is here. Just worship him for a moment. Just lift your hands and cry out and say, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Lord, thank you for letting us be here, Lord. Thank you for honoring us with your presence tonight, Lord God. Thank you for getting us here safely, Lord. Thank you for keeping us so far this week, Lord God. Lord, thank you for healing our bodies. Thank you for speaking to us, Lord, letting our eyes and our ears and our hearts be open tonight, Lord. Lord, help us to honor you, Lord God. Help us never to fail to give you praise, Lord God, for all that you've done for us. Oh, thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. Wow. Who's glad to be in the house of the Lord tonight? You know, this is our filling station. We made it halfway through the week. Started running a little bit low on fuel. We come right back in here and we gotta get plugged in and get filled up again. We have to think of that, guys. You know, we're all human. We're going to wear down a little bit. It's just like our vehicles. You run your body just like you run your vehicle. You run it too hard and too fast, you're going to run out of fuel quickly. That's how we do our bodies, spiritually and physically. And if we don't keep our minds upon the Lord, we'll start to run out of fuel. And as we start to run out of fuel, that's when the enemy starts to try to come in and get you, so to speak, spark plug going out a little bit. But we come in here and the Lord says, here you go, let me put some of that additive in your tank so your injectors will be firing on all cylinders for the rest of the week. Whew, that was free. Wasn't even part of... That wasn't even part of what I was studying today. Or as Brother Ron would say, that's tweetable. I love it. We're going to be in John chapter 8 tonight. We all know this story. We're going to start in verse 1 and we're going to read through verse 11. Now, I'm actually going to read this twice to you. I'm going to read it the first time in the King James Version. And then I'm going to read it to you in the Amplified. It breaks it down a little bit more in the Amplified, and it really puts some things into perspective to me. Perspective for me today when I was studying. But starting in verse 1, it says, Jesus went unto the Mount of Olives, and early in the morning he came again into the temple. And all the people came unto him. He sat down, and he taught them. And the scribes and Pharisees brought unto him a woman taken in adultery. Now, you know, I was reading this, and part of me said, you know, were they laying a trap for that woman? You know, how did she really get caught? I was sitting there going, how is it they knew she was there? What was, you know, how did this happen? And I started reading into this, and it says it again. It says, when they had set her in the midst, they said unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. But what sayest thou? They're tempting Jesus. They're wanting to see what his response is going to be. This they said, tempting him, that they might have to accuse him. They're looking for any reason to accuse Jesus. But Jesus stooped down and with his finger wrote on the ground as though he heard them not. He didn't listen to the demons that were trying to get in his head. So when they continued asking him, he lifted himself up and he said to them, He that is without sin among you, let him first cast a stone at her. And again he stooped down and wrote on the ground. And they which heard it, being convicted of their own conscience, went out one by one, beginning at the eldest, even unto the last. And Jesus was left alone with the woman, and the woman standing in the midst. When Jesus had lifted himself up, and saw none but the woman, he said to her, Woman, where are those of thine accusers? Hath no man condemned thee? She said, No man, Lord. And Jesus said to her, Neither do I condemn thee. Go and sin no more. Now we're going to read this one more time in the Amplified. And it says here, But Jesus went to the Mount of Olives. Early in the morning he came back into the temple or the court. And all the people were coming to him. He sat down and began teaching them. Now the scribes and the Pharisees brought a woman who had been caught in adultery. They made her stand in the center of the court. And they said to him, Teacher, this woman has been caught in the very act of adultery. Now in the law of Moses commanded us to stone such a woman to death. What do you say to do with her, and what is your sentence? They said this to test him, hoping that they would have grounds for accusing him. But Jesus stooped down and began writing on the ground with his finger. You know, I was wondering, what was he writing on the ground? What was he writing? Doesn't say what he was writing. But he was doing something. However, when they persisted in questioning him, he straightened up. He stood up. He had had enough of it. He said, He who's without any sin, not a sin, any sin among you, let him be the first to throw a stone at her. Then he stooped down again and started writing on the ground. They listened to his reply, and they began to go out one by one, starting with the oldest ones, until he was left alone with the woman, standing there before him in the center of the court. Straightening up, Jesus said to her, Woman, where are they? Did no one condemn you? She answered, No one, Lord. And Jesus said, I do not condemn you either. Go. From now on, sin no more. You know, we see this as an act of what this woman was doing. Everybody looks at that state that this woman was, you know, committing adultery against her husband. You know, a couple weeks ago when I preached on 1 Timothy, I think it was 3, you know, we are to be, when we're leaders in the church or in our home, we have to be a one-woman man. Well, this one, or a one-woman, or excuse me, a one-woman man or a one-man woman. Anyway, this woman wasn't being that way. Sorry, I got myself confused. She wasn't being like that. She stepped out. Well, most of the time when we read this verse, we only see the woman. We don't see anything else. We don't see really, you know, some people don't even see what Jesus did for her. Because you can't get past the fact that this woman committed a sin that we all, think is just really, really bad. Which it is. I'm not saying it's not. But I want you to sit here and I want you to picture this for me. I want you to imagine someone you love. Put yourself in the place of this woman. You're the one who did it. Now you're the one standing in the court. People got rocks in their hands ready to kill you for what you've done. Changing your perspective a little bit? Because most people don't put themselves in the place of that woman. She was doing wrong. We know that. She got caught. She was brought to stand before Jesus. A crowd of people looking on you. Think about that. That you are doing wrong. That you've been caught. And now your drug, right up here in the middle of everybody. Everybody looking down on you. Because I promise you, If somebody got drugged through that door right now, you would look down on that person to a certain extent for at least for a fraction of a moment. Because you would think, how dare her? You'd be ashamed as you looked at the ground, as those around you humiliated you. Because you know they were making fun of her. Put yourself in the place of this woman. Now, you know, as I was reading, you know, it says, none of us are exempted from this. You might not have done what she did. But anytime you go against the word of God, you are committing adultery against Jesus. At that point, you're no different than she is. I'm going to say it again. When you go against the word of God, you're no better than she was, and you're committing adultery against Jesus. There's not one person in here that can say that they haven't done it. Not one of us. If you're honest, we've all done it. We've all stepped out on the master. Because we let this world entice us enough to where it was more important than what he had for us. You might say to yourself, how can I say that? I can see you people questioning that. But I've been there. I've ran completely against the word of God more than one time. So I can say that because I've lived that. And you might say, well, how can you say that? Well, let's put it in another perspective. Have you ever judged somebody? Have you ever judged somebody? Let's pull up Matthew 7, 1 through 3. And we're going to start in the NLT. Everybody knows this one too. Do not judge others, and you will not be judged. For you will be treated as you treat others. The standard you use in judging is the standard by which you will be judged. Have you ever thought about that? You ever remember those things when you're looking down at somebody? And why worry about the speck in your friend's eye when you have a log in your own? You're gagging at a gnat and swallowing a camel. If you go on over to the Amplified verse, it says, do not judge and criticize and condemn others unfairly with an attitude of self-righteous superiority as though assuming the office of a judge. How many of us in here, and you have to raise your hand, have ever assumed the office of a judge? The only one that we've had in this church that could actually do that was Sharon. Because she was a judge. The rest of us don't have a right. So that you will not be judged unfairly. For as you hypocritically judge others, when you are sinful and unrepentant, so will you be judged. And in accordance with your standard of measure used to pass out judgment, judgment will be measured to you. Why do you look at the insignificant speck that is in your brother's eye, but you do not notice and acknowledge the, I can't pronounce that word, egregious log that is in your own eye? What that means is, I can look at, say, Brother Kent, you're standing, I made eye contact with you. I can look at Brother Kent and say, you know what? I can't believe that you would lie about that thing yesterday. Well, I'm accusing you. 9 times out of 10, when somebody accuses you, it's because they do the same thing, and usually worse. So at that point, I'm pointing my finger at him. But when I point that finger at him, I got 3 more pointing at myself. We have to be careful how we look at folks. We have to look at, you know, we have to be careful on how we speak. I'm going to ask you again, how can I say that? Have you ever been mean or have an attitude with somebody? Let's go to Matthew 7, 12. Everybody knows this as the golden rule. In the NLT first, do to others whatever you would like them to do to you. This is the essence of all that is taught in the law and the prophets. Swing over to the Amplified. So then, in everything, treat others the same way you want them to treat you. For this is the essence of the law and the writings of the prophets. Let me ask you this. How do you treat your spouse? You can treat them really, really good in here. How do you treat your kids? How do you treat a complete stranger? I want y'all to think about all these things. We'll come back around to the woman, because when you put yourself in that place, all these people were doing these things to her. They were being mean. They were being spiteful. They were being hurtful. They didn't care what she thought. They didn't care how she felt. They thought they were better than her because they didn't get caught doing what she did. But I promise you, they all walked away. They couldn't throw a stone at her. So that just meant they had broke those rules too. Bottom line is they just hadn't get caught. I'll use my brother and mine, our lives example. You know, my brother and I both fell out of church. You know, I was wild. I ran around being dumb. My brother was 10 years younger than me. He started a little earlier than I did. But my brother happened to get caught. I should have. I did some of the same things he did. But it just so happened that my brother got caught. And there for a while, I looked down my nose at him. And I've told y'all this story, that I had a hatred grow up to my brother. Now, I had turned my life over to God. I'm holier than him. That's the way I was acting. I was being no different than the people that were standing there pointing the finger at that woman. So, man, Lord forgive me. I'm glad God forgave me. That's all I can tell you. But I was treating him the way these people were treating this woman, as a dog, as somebody that was just, I wasn't treating him like Jesus. I was thinking from my own perspective, what I saw. I was wrong, just as these people were wrong. At that point, my brother and I both were no different than the woman. We were guilty, headed for hell, just as this woman was. It's awful quiet in here tonight. You know, the one thing it took me a while to realize, and it was later on in years, and all of us should have pretty much the same Bible in here, that no one sin was greater than the other. So having a bad attitude towards my family, towards my brother, made me just as guilty as this woman. Not telling the truth to somebody made me just as guilty as that woman. Cutting a corner, bending the rules, makes me no different than this woman because I wasn't being honest. We've all bent this. We've all been here. But we think in our minds that we're better than her because we didn't do exactly what she did. Boy, are we blind. Sin is exactly what it is. Sin. There's no major sin, there's no minor sin. Sin is sin. So what I want you to do now is I want you to put that rock down. When something happens and people come to you and you think, you know, you see this issue, put that rock down. Put yourself in their position for just a moment and feel what they're going through. Some of you might have been caught in different things. Some of you might not have. You know, I might not have got caught, but I regret everything I did. Because I should have never done it. I knew what was better. I knew what was right, and I did. You know, I went a completely opposite way. I was no different than the woman. Quit beating others down. Put the rock down. Don't keep bringing up things. Love like Jesus. Now we see how this woman standing in the middle. I'm not going to pick on you this time. Amy, come up here for a second. I got in here that's mean? Come on, Gabby. You'll be good at this. This woman was caught in the act. She sinned. You ain't helping my analogy here. And I want you to make fun of her. I want you to. I want you to. I want you know what? Here, throw this at her. Throw it at her. Now say something mean. She was caught. She stole from you. She hit the side of your brand new car. Seriously, I want you to lash at her. Just, you know, I do it like hardcore mean, but I want you. I know, don't be mean, but just and jokingly do it for me. This woman's guilty. I know they can't. Say it loud. She's mean. This woman has been guilty. Okay, fine. She was caught with your husband. She said, give me that mic. What would you do at that point? If you caught her in the act with your husband, what would you do? You would beat that woman into the ground, correct?
In the parking lot.
In the parking lot, okay. But I want you to say, now. Now I want you to flip the role. Now what? You would beat that woman down, right? You wouldn't love like Jesus.
No, I'd be mad.
You'd be mad. So with that being said, what would you do? She'd wind up and throw it at her. She would hit her. She'd do whatever she could to take her frustration out on the guilty party. Thank you. Sit down, ladies. Thank you so much. Give them a round of applause. Thank you very much. That was kind of impromptu. But the bottom line is I know every woman in here, if they were caught in that position, they'd be ready for blood. Every man in here, if they were caught in that position, would be ready for blood. But put your rock down. Love like Jesus. No one sin is greater than the other. There's not no major sin. There's not no minor sin. Sin is sin. Jesus could have had that woman put to death. Quickly, all he would have said is, kill her. It would have been over for that woman. She would have been gone, snuffed out. He could have rubbed her out just like an ant. How many of y'all got an ant on your body? What do you do? You just reach out there. End of that. Jesus could have made one comment and that woman would have died. But he didn't. Just like in the story, Jesus chose to love and forgive. Just like we have a choice. Are we going to forgive and love? Are we going to keep committing adultery on him and letting ourselves go against the word? What's more important to you? This world or the gospel in Jesus? How loyal are you? Yeah, you come in here every Sunday morning, Sunday night, and Wednesday afternoon, or Wednesday evening. But are you here out of obligation or because you desire to be? Because you can sit right here and be thinking about something else and be here for no reason. And this is true. That's right. She was caught in the act, but where was the man? Ooh, that's good. They didn't bring him. They just brought her. Got a point. He said the reason they couldn't stone her is because the man should have been brought too. And if they tried to stone her and they didn't bring him, it would have been impartial, and that would have been against the law. Never thought about that, but you're right. Yeah, society doesn't see that now. It was just her and Jesus in the end. It's just like when we die, guys. It will just be you and him. Jesus forgave her. He didn't punish her. How many of us will punish the people that hurt us? Keep bashing them and beating them over the head with the same stick. Even though you said you're sorry. Well, if you say you're sorry to Jesus and Jesus forgets, why can't you? You know, Jesus took her place. He didn't punish her. He took her place, and he died on the cross for her sins, just like he's done for every single one of us. He hasn't punished us. He forgives us. He washes us white as snow. We're the ones that can't get past it. We keep allowing ourselves to be humiliated. We keep allowing ourselves to stand in the middle of the courtroom and get bashed when our sins have already been forgiven. You know, sometimes we tend to deny our sin. We diminish our sin. We blame others for our sin. But the great part of all of it is Jesus forgives it all. As Jesus did for the woman, he lifts condemnation. If Jesus didn't condemn, what gives us the right to think that we can? Let that sink in for a minute. What gives us the right to think that we are better? I already told you the story about my brother. I was worried about the speck in his eye when I had the log in my eye. I had hatred. I had resentment. I had unforgiveness. I couldn't give up those things because, you know, I was justifying it. Just like I just said, I was justifying it. Oh, well, the way he acts, you know, I hate the sin, love the sinner. Well, the problem was I got to where I hated the sin and the sinner. And if we don't watch out, we will continue to do those things. You'll think you're justified by being upset. Well, they wronged me. There's a difference between righteous anger and unrighteous anger. Well, the problem is you might start off righteous, but 9 times out of 10, it's going to swap. And you're going to let that little seed get in there of hatred and resentment and bitterness. And before you realize it, there's a tree there, and it's hard to uproot a tree. I told you this a couple weeks ago. I've got a grapevine that I've been trying to kill for 15 years, but I've never made it down to the root. I've cut it, I've chopped it, I've put diesel, rock salt, I've sprayed stuff in it, straight Roundup, gasoline, you name it, I've done it, and I cannot kill that grapevine. It'll go away for a while, and you'll see where I cut it loose from the bottom, and all the leaves and little vines will start to die up and wither up. But then, as time goes, it comes back. So if you don't uproot the hatred that you have in your heart, the resentment that you have in your heart, the aggravation that you have in your heart, it will come up again. It's a ticking time bomb to where the littlest thing, it's like a powder keg, where the littlest thing is going to set it off. And then usually when it goes off, it's ugly because all the stuff you thought you had already dealt with and you had held back, it all comes out like a volcano. Blech. And when it does, it's usually ugly. What gives us the right to condemn? Jesus didn't give us that right. If Jesus didn't condemn, what gives us the right to think we can? Sometimes if it's just condemning ourselves, we can live without condemnation. Romans 8:11 in the Amplified. Therefore, there is now no condemnation, no guilty verdict, no punishment for those who are in Christ Jesus, who believe in him as their personal Lord and Savior. So as soon as you believe and as soon as you ask him for forgiveness, there is now. It doesn't say in 15 years. It doesn't say when I deal with it. It says now there is no condemnation. Thank you, Jesus, right. No guilty verdict. It says in the Amplified that she was brought to the center of the court before Jesus. He didn't render a guilty verdict. He didn't render any punishment. He said, go and don't do it anymore. Jesus gave her, or yourself, or us, he gave us dignity. He gives us our dignity back. Because, you know, the enemy's going to beat you down just as this woman was beat down by the people. Felt like you're this big, you're not worth anything. But the Lord gave her dignity back. Not only did Jesus forgive her, but you know what he called her? Woman. He didn't call her a hooker. He didn't call her a harlot or a whore. He didn't call her an adulteress. He called her a woman. And I'm going to tell you why that's significant. Because in John 2:4, he referred to his mother as woman. He was then treating her with the same dignity and the respect that he gave his own mom. He didn't condemn her. He didn't punish her. He didn't make her do 15 jumping jacks and stand on her head. He gave her her dignity back. He didn't call her anything derogatory. I've been around a lot of different places in my life and seen things and saw people do things wrong, done them wrong myself. And most of the time you get called mean names. Most of the time you're talked down to. Most of the time, you know, you basically feel like a little bitty speck. It wasn't until I found Jesus that I knew what the freedom was. That I knew what it was like to live without condemnation. Jesus is calling to her and to us. He's calling us saying, here, go do it. Here's an alternate lifestyle. Do something different. Change into the holiness role. He's telling her, when he tells her, go and sin no more, he's just telling her, hey, change your life. The easiest way I can put righteousness was right living. I saw that years ago. And it's always stuck with me. Go and do right. You know the law. You know the rules. Don't bend them. Don't break them. Be a good person. Now, I'm ad-libbing all those things, but that's what I think about when I think about go and sin no more. Don't lie to your boss and tell him you're sick. That really got me the other day when we were talking, you know. Because I've done that. I've lied to people, said, I'm sick, you know. I'm not coming to work, you know. Don't lie to your children. Tell them the truth. That's a big one. I'm a parent. I've lied to them before just to get them to get off my back. I've done it. Doesn't make it right, but I've done it. I've had to ask for forgiveness for it. Don't be mean to the homeless man walking down the street when he's looking for food. Put yourself in the position of these people that have got something going on. You know, Amy and I have talked about this more than once, and it's a heart without God. We've talked about it over and over and over, all of us, David and Pam, all of us. We've talked, you know, you have to be careful because a person that has a heart without God is a totally different animal. But it doesn't give me the right to say, man, they're pathetic. Because they're in the same place as this woman. In the same place that I have been. He told her, he said, go and sin no more. He didn't say anything else. He didn't make her say a prayer. There was no strings attached. There was no strings attached to her. They can't say nothing to you. I'm forgiving you. Go and sin no more. That was it. He didn't say, come back for a counseling session in 2 weeks and bring $49.95. He didn't say those things. Go and sin no more. Live right. Do what you know to be right. Jesus is going to return one day. I believe it's closer than we think. We better be looking for it. But when he does, he's going right back to the same place as he was when this story happened. According to Zechariah 14:4, it says, "And in that day his feet will stand on the Mount of Olives." That's where this all started. He'd retreated to the mountain. He went back into town. He's coming back. And when he gets back, how's he going to find you? Will you look like this woman? Will you be committing adultery with your sin? Caught with your pants down, so to speak? Or will you be like the new woman who is forgiven and sin no more? How will Jesus find you? The choice is yours, just as the choice was mine. What choice are you going to make, Renee? I'm not asking for a response, but I mean, seriously, what choice are you going to make? I'm picking on you because you're on the front row. What has Jesus forgave you for? Lots of things, exactly. What has Jesus forgave you for? You know, there's a room in here that even you don't want to go into. But he forgave you for that. I don't care how long ago it was. I don't care what you did. God forgave you for it. At one point, we were all going to hell. And he forgave us. So as you go every day, I want you to think about this. I want you to say, man, before you react, I want you to engage that brain and say, was I guilty of any of this? You can pretty much say you were, because no one sin is greater than the other. What did Jesus forgive you for? Have you stopped and walked away from that sin? Just because you're here don't mean you don't do things in secret. Being in these walls don't make you right. I already said it. Are you here out of obligation or because you want to be? Desire for the Spirit of the Lord to be a part of your life. Just because you're here doesn't mean you're going to make heaven. There are going to be people sitting on these pews when everybody else is gone. So how is the Lord going to find you when he steps back on the Mount of Olives? Is he going to find you guilty? Or is he going to find you forgiven? If you haven't walked away from your sin, now's a good time. Paul said he had to repent daily. I have to. If that man had to, I know I have to. It don't take much to get certain people riled up or get them thinking mean. I've been there. But God forgave me. You know, I want y'all, my favorite, and I've said this before, my favorite character in the Bible is David. He said he was a man after God's own heart. David committed murder. David committed adultery. He was not always the perfect example for the nation. But you know, the Lord said he was a man after his own heart. He was quick to repent. He was very quick to repent. And it never says that he was a repeat offender, like some of us. And because he would sin and turn away from it, and he might make another mistake, but he would turn away from that as well. God said he was a man after his own heart. He was that woman. Several hundred years before that parable ever, the story ever came, he was that woman. And if God can forgive all the things that David did, he can forgive me. If he can forgive that woman, he can forgive me. Don't let nobody talk you down. If Jesus isn't doing it, nobody else has a right to. In closing, I know it's not real long tonight, but if you haven't stopped your sin, I know a way for you to be able to. And I know a way for you to be forgiven. And I know a man that walked this earth that was out without no sin. And I would love to introduce you to him. With every head bowed and every eye closed, if anybody in here tonight doesn't know Jesus, or if you just need a fresh refill, you might not have stepped out on your spouse or anything like that, but you've stepped out on him. If you just need to make things right, now's the time to do it. Time is short, and the Lord's coming back soon. And is he going to find you with a robe white as snow? Or is he going to find you with a robe that has a few spots on it? Lord, I ask tonight that you would just forgive us, Lord. Lord, we have failed you so many times. But Lord, you've always been there to keep the stones from hitting us. Lord, you've always been there to forgive us. Lord, I thank you for loving me. I thank you for forgiving me. If nobody else in here says thank you, Lord, I don't want to fail. I don't want a rock to cry out for me. Lord, I love you and I thank you, Father. Thank you for your son. Thank you for letting him die for me. Thank you for letting him die for every person that's in this place tonight. Lord, I ask tonight as we're here, Lord God, that you would speak to us and help us to see the areas where we need your help. Lord, we're not perfect and we make mistakes, Lord, but with you, all things are possible and we can make heaven our home as long as we keep you in the center of all we do and say. Lord, help us to remember to treat others with respect. Help us to love them the way that we want to be loved. Help us to treat them the way we want to be treated, Lord. And Lord, I ask that you would forgive this house, Lord God. Lord, our desire is to see you move. Our desire is to see you, Heavenly Father, Lord, rule and reign. Lord, help us not get in your way today. Oh, Lord, I thank you. The altars are open, guys. If there's something that you need to put a stop to, the altar is the best place to start. If you just want somebody to pray with you and lift you up so that you can have a little extra strength going on through the week, we're here to pray. There's strength in numbers. Don't let the enemy try to just single you out. Let us be able to stand with you. Thank you for forgiving me, Lord. As I was that woman, Lord, I thank you, Lord, for allowing me the opportunity, Lord, to be forgiven. Lord, the opportunity to see your love and your mercy work. Every breath that I take, Lord God, is a testament to your love and a testament to your goodness and your mercy, Lord God. If nobody else has anything to thank God for, you can thank God just for the air you breathe. We were made to thank God. We were made to give him glory. We were made to praise. If you can't praise now, Amy said this on Sunday, you're not going to like heaven very much because that's all we're going to be doing. He gave everything for you. Now give everything back to Him. Nothing I have is mine. My wife is not mine. My children are not mine. I am stewards of these things, but the Lord blessed me with them, and I gave them back to Him to tell Him how thankful I was that I even had a chance to be in this, in these relationships that I have. This church, I have given it to Him because I am honored to stand here with you guys. My life is His. We should think the same way. Sing it, Amy.
Majesty.
Lift your hands. Lift your hands. Give thanks to the one who created you. Give thanks to the one who forgave you. Give thanks to the one who sent His Son to die for you.
Your grace has found me just as I am.
Tonight.
In the presence of Your Majesty.
I heard it best that if God has not changed you, He's done nothing for you. There's somebody out here tonight that's fighting anger and they're fighting unforgiveness. I don't know who it is. I'm not telling you got to come up here, but let it go. Don't let it poison the water hole. You can have a 55-gallon drum of water and put one drop of oil in it, and the whole 55 gallons is contaminated. Don't let this contamination continue. Filter it. Purge it. Don't let it take root. I don't know who that's for tonight. How bad do you want revival? How bad? We talk about it a lot. Do you really want to sit at His feet? Nothing's holding you back but yourself and hair. We have to take that step. We're seeing so many things the Lord's doing here. But we can't be complacent and just sit and not desire more.
Majesty, we worship You, Majesty.
voices.
Majesty. Your grace has found me just as I am.
So awesome. All you have to do is give yourself to the Lord. You don't have to bring anything but yourself. You don't have to bring some special gift. You don't have to do something. You just have to submit. You know, we were taught at our leadership conference that submission is power. And the more you worship, the more you'll enter in, the more you'll submit. The more you'll feel His longing, the more you'll feel His tugging. You know, if we would treat the Lord the way that we treat our girlfriend when we first started finding Him, and you can't have enough, you talk all hours of the day and night, every moment. If we would treat the Lord with the same, Lord, if we would chase Him the way we would chase our girlfriend or our boyfriend, what more would we have from Him? What kind of signs and wonders would we see? Thank you, Father.
Majesty.
With a grace.
Empty-handed, but alive in your hands. Grace has found me just as I am. Empty-handed, but alive in your hands. Singing majesty.
If anybody would like prayer, y'all come on up.
I want.
wanting to look to talk to you through dreams and visions. Open the Word. Let that Word be alive. Let it speak to you. Let it see. Let you see the page, the letters running off the page because it's speaking to you in such a manner. I want all the Lord has for my family and I want all the Lord has for you. I want to see you on fire. I want to see you pushing. I want to see you so hungry that you'll do anything to get closer.
Show me your glory, my God.
Yes.
We're singing majesty.
Singing majesty. Thank you, Father.
Forever I am changed by your love.
Thank you, Lord, for changing. Make us, Lord, what you need us to be, Lord God. Put us back on that potter's wheel, Lord God, that we can be what you need us to be, not what we desire to be, God. Lord, tonight as we close the service, Lord, I ask that your will would be done in each and every one of our lives, Lord God. And that as we leave this place, Lord God, that we keep our minds stayed upon you in a manner, Lord God, that we've never done before. Lord, help us to live for you every moment of the day. Lord, help us to look for ways to honor you. Help us to thank you, Lord God. Help us never to fail to give you praise and honor. Lord, I thank you tonight. Shield every person as they go home tonight. We're going to continue praising and worshiping. Service is closed. If you got to go, we understand. We'll see y'all Sunday morning at 10 o'clock. But if you want to stay, the presence is sweet up here. I don't know if anybody else can feel it back there, but I know I can feel it right here. Thank you, Father. Sing it again, Amy.
Majesty.